Hello and welcome back to the MedCity News Insights Lounge from the Oliver Wyman Health Innovation Summit. I'm Kevin Trong and I'm here today with Todd Mantall, Senior Vice President of Healthcare Value at Blue Cross Blue Shield Michigan. Todd, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks, Kevin. It's a pleasure to be here.
So a major topic of conversation among payer organization is, you know, building the network of the future. So I'm kind of curious on how your organization is thinking about building that next generation network.
There's a lot of attention right now on next generation networks, high performance networks, and what that means and it will require across different lines of business. So you think about the Blues and Blue Cross Blue Shield of Michigan in particular, we've had tremendous success over the past three decades really with a broad access open network, PPO network, powered by Blue Card. It's been something that has allowed for national account employers across multiple states and geographies to have a powerful, effective, accessible, and low-cost network available to them. We are now seeing certain pressures in the market across different market segments to say, are there opportunities to sculpt or change that network in certain ways? You see folks interested in narrow networks, tiered networks, and as a system, we're working on a number of those. The Blues in 2021 will have a high-performance network nationally available across the top 50 markets at a high-quality, lower price point. And so there will be times where narrow networks make sense.
Right.
But I think what we'll increasingly be talking about at BCBSM and across the Blues is how do we build smarter networks? And there's all kinds of opportunity that we have out there now as we get reimbursement models better aligned, moving away from fee-for-service to fee-for-value so that physicians are paying greater attention and accountability for cost and quality. As we look at the richness of data that's out there around physician performance, whether it be cost or quality or appropriateness, and you begin to see that we also have additional ways and tools to partner with providers to influence things like referral patterns. So yes, there'll be a need for narrow networks, alternative networks, but increasingly we're just gonna have smarter networks that we're figuring out how to help our consumers better navigate.
Yeah, when you talk about smarter networks, maybe we can elaborate a little bit more on that and how you're using kind of a data-enabled approach to actually build those and enable those and ensure that, you know, it is leading to better care outcomes and better cost outcomes for patients.
Great question. We have a lot of interest from, let's just take, for example, the large group self-insured market.
Okay.
Large employers who continue to have concerns about the affordability of healthcare benefits for their employees and the growing cost of healthcare benefits on their P&L. What they are pushing us for is to say, how do we begin to define what performance looks like in these networks? We have incredibly richer and richer data sets around cost, quality, and appropriateness, and we can begin to shape and construct those in new and novel ways that meet employer demands. Most employers don't want to be in the business of restricting access of their employees. They want to preserve choice, but they do want to see plans like ours take a more active hand in how we inform their members, how we build accountability into our provider relationships, and how we are ensuring that their employees are increasingly in high value care relationships that deliver the care that they need at the best price and at the highest possible quality.
So I'm going to hone in on high value. I mean, there's so much innovation happening in healthcare now. I mean, I think this conference is kind of a testament to that. I mean, how do you go about approaching which innovations actually can lead to higher value care for patients?
So in the healthcare world, we're very data rich.
Right.
We don't always have all the insights that we want, but we're very data rich. And I think we are beginning to better understand and establish standards for what, from an innovation standpoint, what constitutes strong performance, right? We increasingly have better tools for assessing the population level cost performance of a physician or a physician practice. We have established through HEDIS and STAR measures, understood measures around what we want to do to measure quality of process and quality of outcomes. We have a growing set of appropriateness criteria that focus on established clinical best practice, evidence-based medicine, and the degree to which different physicians are aligning with that. And the innovation will come through, one, when we have a better understanding of what constitutes good performance, and that's often a very complex question. It's one that we have to have physician buy-in to. Two, when those providers and physicians have the right incentives, away from a fee-for-service, but to a fee-for-value model, and then we work with those physicians to put the right information at point of care so that they can be more aligned with evidence-based practice, so that they can have a better understanding of different referral options and implications, and really put a lot of powerful information and tools and incentives in the hands of that, in particular, the primary care physician.
Right. Since you said that a lot of the self-insured market isn't interested in necessarily limiting options or limiting access to care, I mean, when you look at actually the individual members and how you're communicating them to actually drive them to high value modes of care, how are you kind of thinking about that problem, the actual communication problem and the navigation issue?
So for about a decade, we've been on a consumerism journey with growth in high deductible health plans. There's different research and data that indicates that that may have peaked, right? We've put a lot of additional cost responsibility and accountability onto the member. We've given them some tools, but I think there's some inherent limitations to which consumers, often who are in moments of need or frail, are going to unleash fully shopping capabilities. There's a role for incentives and things like different co-pays or co-insurance and ways to steer towards better performing physicians, or even things like labs and obviously pharmaceuticals and formulary design. But we think it's really powerful if we can put that information and those incentives in the hands of the physician.
Right.
The physician relationship that they trust, that hopefully they build over a period of time. And when they are have the right care relationship, and that physician has the information tools, highly usable, worked into their practice flow with the right incentives, they're going to make sure.
So they can provide that info in context to the patient themselves.
And play a more active role in how they navigate, ultimately leading to getting them into better care relationships with better outcomes.
So why don't we finish with this? I know from the association level, a major priority for the Blues is tackling social determinants of health, figuring out new ways of addressing some of the social needs that have a major impact on health as a whole. I mean, how is Blue Cross Blue Shield Michigan thinking about that?
A couple examples.
Sure.
One is just a growing focus on behavioral health, whether it's in our Medicare population or in the commercial population. There is an increasing awareness of behavioral health need, a destigmatization of those needs, and a growing understanding that we need to support behavioral health needs if we're to also address physical health needs. So we'll continue to make investments in what we offer to our customers from a behavioral health standpoint and an expanding set of services and capabilities. And then two, a lot of the very interesting social determinant work is happening in the Medicare space, where you're seeing the growth of home-based care, getting into individuals' living environments, understanding the care support system that they have around them, the environment that they have, and CMS increasingly expanding supplemental benefits related to tackling things like food insecurity or transportation challenges. And I think that just represents an increasingly enlightened and broad understanding of not just what somebody needs to do to access healthcare, but to live a healthy, full life.
Todd, thank you so much for sharing your insights about this issue.
Thank you.